Hello, welcome to New Harvest Christian Fellowship, Manchester, England, and thank you for subscribing to our sermon podcast. The message you're about to hear was recorded live at one of our recent services. We pray it will be a blessing to your life, and if you'd like to get in touch with us, we'll give you our contact information at the end of the recording. Thank you once again. Enjoy the preaching. Thank you for making it out to church. As we said last week, it's Love Month. We've been looking at different aspects of the topic of love, and we're going to carry on with that this evening. This evening, I want to look at something that is a little different, I suppose, but it fits along with the theme that we've been looking at, and that's the idea of love your church. How many can remember what we looked at last Wednesday? Love your neighbour, that's right. How have you been getting on with loving your neighbour? Amen. God been blessing your life through loving your neighbor. Amen. I know that he's been blessing your neighbor through your life, but God will bless you as you put it into practice also. And let's pick up tonight with the scripture that we ended with last week, which is Galatians chapter 6, verse 10. And that's the one that says, "As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially to those who are of the household of faith." Amen. Let's pray this evening. Lord, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord God, that, Lord God, the faith that you have brought us to is not just some abstract spiritual thing, Lord God, but it's practical. It works out, Lord God, that as we begin to put your word into practice, God, we can change the world around us. And we thank you that you use us to bring good and blessing into people's lives. Oh, God, bless this word tonight, Father God. Encourage and stir our hearts. Build our church, Lord God. Help us to build one another and receive all of the blessing and the glory and the honor through this work tonight, Lord God. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Praise God. So let's pick up on this scripture tonight. Amen. It's big enough to read, I think, up there just about. "As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially to those who are of the household of faith." Well, there's a couple of things that stick out to me right here in this, just by way of introduction. It starts off and it says, "As we have therefore opportunity." How many know what an opportunity is? It's a chance. If you have opportunity, you have a chance to do something, a chance to make a difference. If you have no opportunity, it doesn't matter what you do. Nothing's ever going to change. But it's interesting there, he doesn't say, "When we have opportunity, let us do good to all men." He says something different. He says, "As we have, therefore, opportunity." In other words, what he's saying is, because we have this opportunity, let us do good to all men. We have opportunity tonight to do good, to exercise our faith in a practical way. And you know what? The church is that opportunity. Church is a great opportunity to put your faith into practice. Church is a great opportunity. We want to know what it means to love people, to work with people, to comfort the weak and to help those, and weep with those who weep, mourn with those who mourn, rejoice with those who rejoice, build people's lives. We want to know what it means to live out all those things that are Christ-likeness in their very essence. Well, church is the place that we do that. So church is this great opportunity to love and serve our fellow believers and put our hand to the plow and work for God's kingdom and do all these different things. An opportunity, though, has to be taken. How many know you won't have opportunity if you're not here, if you're not part of what God is doing upon the earth? So whether you're here in person tonight or listening by podcast, let me tell you that God has got a place for you in his church. You know, we're happy to have you here. We're blessed that you're part of our physical church right here. But if you're listening in some other place, God has a purpose for you. You're not just a believer just to be a believer in isolation. God's got other people's lives that he wants you to bless, that he wants to involve you in, so that you can be part of their growth and their maturing and just everything that God wants to give them is going to come in part through your input into their lives. This is a wonderful thing that we're all part of here. You may feel that you don't have much to contribute to this process, but let me tell you a couple of things. First of all, just by physically turning up tonight, you've encouraged people. Amen? The fact that you're here tonight, I'm going to start over there with Sean and I'm going to go all the way across. Every single one of you tonight have encouraged me, amen, by coming to this service. And you've encouraged one another by coming to this service. If you're married tonight, you've encouraged your wife, your husband, by coming along with them and saying, let's go to church together. If you're a young person, that's encouraging, you know, to see someone who's saying, you know what, I want to set my life apart. I could be in the pub drinking and doing stuff tonight, but I've come to hear the word of God. What an encouraging thing that is. So just by coming, you encourage people and you impart into their lives. But as well as that, those of you who are in ministry, where would the church be without your valuable contribution? Amen. Our worship team tonight, our usher, amen, our sound people and our ministry media, the person that opened the door, the person that's going to lock the door at the end, amen. All of these people are blessing our lives, amen. So we have this opportunity. Never neglect this opportunity. It's a great opportunity that God gives you to express your faith in a practical way. But he goes on and he says, listen, as we have this opportunity, yeah, as we saw last week, let us do good to all men. Let us love our neighbor. But then he adds something on and he says, especially to those who are of the household of faith. Especially, especially. This word means most. It means in the greatest degree. It means particularly do this, chiefly do this, most of all, the most important thing. So he's saying this is even more important, more critical than just our normal neighborly conduct, which we looked at. And we know that Christ calls us to love our neighbor wherever we may find our neighbor. But he says, listen, if you're going to do that, especially do this in the church, especially to those who are of the household of faith. In an even greater degree, you need to be applying these teachings in the church which you're a part of and the group of Christians that you're around. And if this is truly the case, we should put priority on this within our lives. Amen? Coming to church is important, but coming to church with an eye and an attitude of saying, I want to love somebody, I want to help somebody, I want to bless somebody, I want to encourage somebody tonight. That's crucial, according to what Christ is telling us. What did Jesus say about this? Well, in John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35, you've read this before. I'm going to pick up my notes here so I can see it very well because it's gone kind of faint, this little part. Jesus says these words. He says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one to another. When Jesus begins to repeat stuff, it's important, and he's trying to make sure we get it. And look how often he says in there that you love one another. And he repeats it, and he repeats it again. So the question here, few questions come out of this. When I begin to read this, and I begin to think about my life, and I begin to think about the way that I live, I have to ask myself and say, here is a test. Am I a real Christian? Do I have a genuine attachment to Christ? Am I truly his follower? Or am I just sticking up a sign outside the door of my life that says that I am, when in reality, I'm living a different thing? Why am I saying that? Because what Jesus says here is kind of really profound. He says that the world outside can judge the truth of our discipleship and our following of Christ by what? He gives a criterion. What is that criterion? Does he say that the world outside can judge the truth of our faith by how we minister to the lost? He doesn't say that. Does he say that the world outside can judge our Christianity by how good our outreach programs are, our social events? He doesn't say that. What about the quality of our worship and our preaching and our biblical understanding and scholarship? He doesn't say that. Jesus says, the world outside can judge us by this one thing, our love for one another. That's what the Bible says here. Christ himself tells us this. This sets me back on my heels. This tells me that Jesus gives the world outside permission to judge our church by what goes on amongst us on the inside. Is that not what the scripture says? That's what the scripture says, isn't it? We're not measured by how we treat them. We're measured by them on how we treat each other. Whoa! This is incredible. And Jesus says, this is not only the test of the truth of our discipleship, whether we're true followers of Christ or not, it's an acid test. It's foolproof. It leaves no doubt. Because he said, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples. Not just they might have a vague idea. He says, they will be able to see with absolute certainty whether you're my true disciples or not. By what? By this. Whether you exhibit this love for one another. So loving each other within the church is absolutely profound. It's a crucial thing, more so than we possibly think. How can this be the case? Because Jesus said it's a commandment. Now, a commandment is not just a nice idea. It's neither just a teaching that we kind of derive from our reading of the Bible and go, oh, I think that God is saying here that he'd rather we kind of live in this way. This is much more direct. The very words of Jesus are written down there in the scripture we just read in the book of John. And Jesus said, a new commandment I give to you. In other words, this is a direct instruction from the throne of God. The very lips of Jesus are telling us and saying, hey, Christians, believers, because that's who he's talking to. He's talking to his disciples at this point when these words were written down. He says, this is what I want you to do. I'm giving you an instruction here. If this was an army, he'd be saying, that's an order. Go do this. This is what I want you to do. If it was Star Trek, he'd be saying, make it so. Amen. However you look at it, John 13:34, a new commandment I give unto you. By saying a new commandment, he's putting it in the same league as the old commandments. And you know what they were? The Ten Commandments written on the tables of stone given by the hand of God to Moses that the nation of Israel lived by. Jesus here is adding an 11th with just as much weight as all those other 10. And he's saying, this is what I want to take place now in the New Testament. I want my believers, I want my, you know, my brothers and sisters in my church. This is what I want above all. I want them to love one another. Amen. It's heavy, isn't it? It's direct commandment from Christ. So it's clear. If we have a commandment from Christ but we don't keep it, we're in disobedience to our Lord because we're not doing what he says. And he says in Luke 6:46, why do you bother calling me Lord, Lord, when you do not do what I say? So this area is absolutely fundamental. Love your church. By love your church, you know, you could have thought, oh, I'm going to go along the thing of, oh, turn up, do lots of work, give your money, you know. No, no, no. The church is the people. We're the church. And Jesus says, if you really want to see things take place, we've got to begin to sort out our relationships and truly love one another. Amen? We're the people that Christ brought in. Amen? I've got some news for you tonight. You're stuck with me. Because Jesus saved me and he brought me into the church. But I can reflect that and I could say I'm stuck with you too, but I won't do that. Amen? Because I'm blessed that you're here. Praise God. But hey, we're family. You know, they always say you can choose your friends, but you can't choose your family. Amen? And we are the family of God. We're the people that Jesus brought together in this geographic place to represent his name to the world around us. And that being the case, we have a commandment from the Lord. We got to love one another. Amen? And work together in harmony to bring glory to his name. Let's move on a little bit here. Don't run away with the idea that when Jesus says we need to love one another, that he's talking about some sort of perfect, insulated, cotton wool wrapped kind of utopian society that we're trying to create here in the church, where nobody ever offends anybody, and everybody has a Christian smile that goes with the big Bible tucked underneath the arm, and there's no strife, there's no misunderstandings, there's no problems, nobody ever has a bad day, nobody is ever grumpy, nobody's ever had a rotten day at work, and they come into church with their head all scrambled and all messed up. That's not what Jesus is talking about here. Let's look at the context of these words that he spoke. He gave this commandment to the disciples at the Last Supper, right before he was going to go out and be crucified. This is not a sugar-coated time. A few verses before Jesus speaks these words, we see him being betrayed to death by one of his closest friends. You know, he who I call a friend, the person that I dipped in the cup with, you know, Judas Iscariot betrays him. And the disciples as well, they considered this man a brother. He was one of them. He was one of the 12. And they're going like, how can this be? You know, even one of our own has betrayed Jesus to death, and they didn't understand. They ran off. Peter went fishing. The whole thing was in turmoil. So this command was given in the context and the midst of a time of great turbulence, of betrayal, of suffering, of anguish, where trust was violated, faith was being shaken, things weren't turning out the way that people thought they were going to turn out, big time. So is Jesus saying, you know, this is a sugar-coated thing? I don't think so. This isn't the way he's looking at it. He's saying, listen, we don't love in an attempt to create some perfect world that's free from suffering. We love one another because we know that we live in a very imperfect world that's full of it. Amen? This is Jesus' antidote for the world in which we live, for the experiences that we have, that he would create this one place, this one element, if you like, called the church, where we can come in, amen, and our brothers and sisters will help us and lift us up. Isn't that a powerful thing? Amen? That Christ would give us that. He ministers his love to us through this edifice that he's created on earth called the church. That's what the church is here for, amen. To put the gospel of Christ into practice, to bind up the brokenhearted, to set the captives free, to heal and help the blind recover, amen. To set at liberty those that are bruised. That's our mandate, that's our mission. It's good, isn't it? I love this. 1 Peter 4:8. Above all these things, have fervent love amongst yourselves. Why? For love shall cover the multitude of sins. No matter what the problem is, we don't sort of go, oh no, this problem's, this isn't working out the way I thought, this person is not being very pleasant to me. No, right, that's it, no love. When those things begin to take place, we turn up the love. Amen? We overcome the multitude of sins, the multitude of problems, the brokenness about us, we overcome it and defeat it with the love of Christ. Amen? And that's what we do. There's loads of scriptures about this in the New Testament. Just run down some of them real quick for you because they've got some good nuggets in. 1 Peter 1:22. Seeing that you've purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, that means you're not pretending that love, it's real. He says, see that you love one another with a pure heart fervently. Romans 13:8. Owe to no man anything but to love one another. For he that loves another has fulfilled the law. We saw that last week. 1 Thessalonians 4:9. But as touching brotherly love, you do not need me to write to you, because you yourselves have been taught by God to love one another. 1 John 3:11. This is the message you heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. 1 John 3:23. And this is his commandment, reminding us what Jesus said, that we should believe on the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandment. 1 John 4:7. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Just a couple more. 1 John 4:11. So did I say that before? That was 7, this is 11, okay? Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. And verse 12, no man has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwells in us, and his love is perfected in us. Amen. Loads of them there. And if you were struggling to get those down, all of our sermons are recorded on the podcast. You can pick it up for free. You can go down. You can stop it and pause it and rewind it and do whatever you want to do just to capture that information if that's important to you. Well, this is beginning to sound good, isn't it? I kind of like the sound of a church where I can go and everybody will just love me. That's wonderful. But that's not quite the way we're supposed to look at church. We're not meant to look at church as a place where we can go just to receive love all the time, although that is true and that is good. According to the scriptures we're reading here, we're supposed to be looking at church as a place where we go to give love to others. And sometimes that can be difficult. But this is ministry. Welcome to ministry. And this is a ministry for all of us. Every single person who's a part of the Church of Jesus Christ has this ministry. Because Jesus didn't give that commandment just to a select group of people. He said, listen, this is for everyone. And we've just read verse after verse after verse after verse, which is being really clear that this should be a universal thing within Christ's church. We should be loving one another. So it's interesting. I've seen over the years various people become disgruntled with the church for one reason or another. And one phrase that often comes out when they're stamping their foot and sticking their lip out is, there's no love in this church. Amen? I've heard that several times. And you know what? That's the wrong perspective. Because if there's no love in this church, in your opinion, then what you need to do is start inputting some. Amen? Rather than stamping your foot and pouting and going, nobody's meeting my needs, nobody's pouring out their life for me, nobody's serving me, nobody's doing things the way I want them done, amen? That's immature. Jesus is calling us to love others. And when we love others and when we serve others, then we'll find our needs met, amen? What does this love look like? Well, let's get a little practical here then. If we're together in the Church of Jesus Christ, then from last week for a start, we understand that that makes us neighbors. And we understand we should love our neighbor as ourselves. So all the things we looked at last week, and if you weren't here last week, you want to catch that, go back on the podcast and refresh your memory. Love your neighbor as yourself. In other words, that means treat other people the way that you would want people to treat you. So if you'd expect them to behave towards you in a certain way, that's the way you should behave to them. If you would not want someone to treat you in a particular way, then don't you do it to others. That's what Christ is teaching us here. And as a church, if you kind of think about what we do when we meet together, this is one of three things. We're either serving other people, we're being served in some way by someone, or we're working together in some kind of team, ministry team, to do some enterprise or serve other people together in connection with others. So there's these three contexts here that we can apply this love. Obviously, serving, we need to serve. If we're receiving some sort of ministry, we should do that with a good attitude and be grateful. And if we're working together in a team, then obviously we got to work together in a team. Can someone say amen? I look at it in two ways. There's things we need to do, acts, but there's also things that it probably would be a good idea not to do, which are omissions. And I've just written down a few here. Now, let me just tell you, all of these that I've written down here, I've seen people either do or not do over the years. And I'm probably also guilty of a fair number of them myself. Amen? So I'm not kind of banging a big drum here. I'm just talking reality. And some of you might go, oh yeah, that one hits home. First of all, what should we do? We should be kind and nice to people. Amen? Nobody wants to come into the church and be greeted by a grump at the door. Amen? We should reach out to people. People should be glad to come. Amen? Same as when you come to your house. You know, some people have those doormats that say, oh no, not you again. Amen? Well, we don't want to put one of those outside the church. We want to be welcoming. And when people come in, they're not going to come in perfect condition. We need to be able to extend love and win them with grace. Be considerate. Be friendly. Don't gossip about people. You know, all this basic common sense stuff. But that goes back to the thing that, you know, treat other people the way that you would want them to treat you. You wouldn't want them digging over and raking over your private business and telling other folk it doesn't concern, then don't do it either. Amen. Respect folks. Amen. Respect is great. You know, there's too much disrespect out in the world. People disrespect authority figures. They disrespect policemen. They disrespect people because their skin is a different color. They disrespect people because of their age. And the list goes on and on and on and on. If you want to go, you want to be disrespected, there's plenty of people out on the streets of Manchester tonight who will give you more than enough disrespect. But we don't need it in the house of God. Everyone who comes to the house of God is a person who Christ died for, worthy of that precious blood. If Jesus considers you a person of worth, then so should I. Amen? And so should we. So the house of God, church, we need to respect one another and appreciate one another for who we are. Speech is obviously a big one. How we talk to each other is critical. And also, how we don't speak to each other is critical. Sometimes, you know, you can say a lot without saying anything. And we need to watch our attitude sometimes, especially if you had a bad day. You know, don't roll your eyes at people and, you know, give them the cold shoulder or... These things don't belong in church. So those are the acts. All common sense stuff. Omissions. Oh, some of these I've been guilty of. Try not to be late every time. Amen. I'm a world expert on being late for things. Amen. So I'm not saying this. I'm pointing the fingers at myself here. The thing is, when you're late all the time, what you're doing is you're kind of disrespecting people who did turn up. You know, because they can't do what they're going to do. The thing can't start because you're late again. Amen. And it's like saying, you know, well, that 15, 20, 25 minutes that you ambled in, you know, they could have been at home with their family. They could have been with their loved ones. They could have been doing something. And it's just like we're saying that their time doesn't matter and their life doesn't matter because I'll turn up when I'm ready. And the fact that everybody else is there is just, well, they should be, shouldn't they? You know, that's an omission, and we shouldn't do that because that's not valuing someone else. Commitments that we made. Our God is a promise keeper, so let's keep our word, amen? Inconsiderate people. I've met some of those. You've probably met some of those as well. You know, they don't seem to think that, you know, you have needs and you have, you know, you're worthy of anything. You know, they'll go, oh yeah, I'll meet you at such and such a place, you know, for a coffee. And you go there and you're sitting there with your coffee and they just don't show up. And they don't bother to let you know they're not coming. That's inconsiderate. I know things turn up, you know, cars break down, dogs get ill, you know, all sorts of stuff, freak weather conditions. Sometimes we can't do what we said we were going to do. But hey, we all have a phone in our pocket. We can pick it up and go, hey, you know what, sorry. And try and do it in good time. It's no good telling them 5 minutes before when they've organized a babysitter and turned down overtime and all sorts of stuff to make that appointment. And taking other people for granted, this is a big, big, big one. You know, there's so many people that do stuff in the church that we never see it day in and day out. And, you know, I mentioned some of them tonight, and I do mention some of them and go out of my way to acknowledge people who do so much work. But maybe not in terms of just ministry. Just don't take people for granted in general. You know, because that brother, that sister, you know, they're praying for you. They're believing God for you. They're standing alongside you. They're encouraging you. You know, they're part of the same thing that you are. And every now and again, it's just good when the Spirit prompts you just to go up to that brother or that sister and go, you know what? Thank you. I just appreciate you for being here. Thank you for helping me. Thank you for doing that. Thank you for that kind word or whatever it might have been. Just to go back and, you know, say thank you. Remember the lepers that Jesus healed? Only one of them came back to say thanks. All the others just went, oh, yippee, I've got my needs met. And off they went, amen. They still got healed, but Jesus said, this one that came back, that's something special. Be an appreciator. Don't take people for granted, amen. Let's move on a little bit here. So our attitude, basically, this boils down to, is important. I've got some verses on attitude that mix in with loving the church as well here. Let's just run down some of these. 1 Timothy 5, 1 to 3. This is interesting. It says, don't rebuke an elder, entreat him as a father, and the younger men as brothers, the elder women as mothers, the younger as sisters, with all purity. Honor widows, that are widows indeed. He's talking there. He's giving instruction to Timothy and saying, listen, Timothy, honor these different people that are in your church. Timothy's the leader of the church, and Paul's telling him here how to relate to these different folk. And we should honor one another and recognize one another for the wonderful people that we are in Christ. Philippians 2:2, fulfill my joy that you be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. That's not saying being clones. You know, we're not going to kind of put some metal cap with wires on your head when you come in and deprogram all your own personality and your own thoughts and desires. That's not what he's saying here. He's saying, listen, if we're going to be of one accord in one mind, we're going to have to focus together on the things that are really important, the stuff that we have in common, and that is being the church of Jesus Christ, exhibiting this love and this grace to one another and doing everything that we possibly can to spread that gospel message everywhere. Amen? Those are the really important things that we all have in common. We may have little things that we don't kind of line up with, you know. No, I don't quite understand the way that she thinks about that. I don't understand his approach here, you know. I have this thing, me and Pastor Tom have this thing going back and forth about Macs and PCs. Pastor Tom is a Mac man. He can work with this stuff. Me, it does my head in. And every now and again, we've got both in the church. We have Macs, which are really good for the media stuff. They're the best machines for that. And we have PCs as well. And every now and again, I'm trying to do something on the Mac. And I have this thing of like, Pastor Tom, you need to come and help me here because it's beginning to infuriate me. Because it's just, I'm like, why won't it let me do this? And he laughs at me because I get infuriated with it. But we can be like that with other people sometimes. Amen? I just don't get where they're coming from. Their mannerisms, their approach, their way of thinking, their logic. It infuriates me. Amen? But let's not focus on those things. Let's focus on the bigger picture of what all these machines are here to do. Amen? Make the service happen. That's the real important thing. The little nuances in the way the computers work, hey, that's just life. Amen? And that's why we have this love. Love, remember, overcomes a multitude of sins. Here's another one. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, pride, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves. Don't let every man look just on his own interests, but every man also on the interests of others. And then he says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ. What mind was that? Read on a few more verses. Who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even the death of the cross. So he's telling us here, if we really want to understand what the right mindset is that we should bring to this thing and our involvement in this thing called the church, we need to look at Christ and see Christ's attitude and see what motivated him and what was going on in his spirit and his mind and his heart. And there's a few things here. Christ had high position. You know, being found in the form of God, it was not robbery for him to be equal with God. He was a person of the Trinity, you know, one of the Trinity of the Godhead. And yet, having that position and the dignity, rights, and privileges that quite legitimately came along with who he was, they were his by right, but he was prepared to let them go for the sake of other people. Man, that needs to be something that's in our hearts. Sometimes when we're in a thing and we're getting angry and we feel, you know, unjustly treated or whatever, you know, hang on a minute. I can get angry here. I can blow my top here. I can cause a ruckus here. I can demand justice here. And all the result from that will be carnage. That won't build the church. That won't win souls. That won't edify people. So I look at myself and I say, that's not the right way to go. Like Christ, I need to lay aside what I think for the sake of the greater cause, for harmony, for love, for presence of the Holy Spirit and the anointing of God and souls to be saved and ministries to succeed. Amen? Jesus went on from there to servanthood. making himself a servant, taking up that mindset of saying, you know what, I'm going to live for other people. I'm going to make my efforts count for other people. My words are going to be for the benefit of other people. That's what Jesus did. And he walked in humility, no pride. He knew who he was, and who he was someone pretty awesome. But yet, he walked in humility, understanding what his calling was and what he came to do. And then obedience followed from that. As the Nike brand says, sometimes just do it. Amen? Just do it and God will bless you. And I got a quote here that sets me back on my heels. If we want to win the world, we first have to learn to defeat ourselves. Because many times, we're the biggest problem. There's a famous quote that says, one person once went to the great preacher D.L. Moody and said, sir, a lot of people have stood against your ministry and said many harsh words about you in the past. Who has caused you the most problems in your career? And he said, you know what? The person who has caused D.L. Moody the most problems through all the years is D.L. Moody. And he was right. We're the biggest problem. I'm going to leave you with this thought. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 talks about the body of Christ. And that's a whole nother sermon we don't have time to get into tonight. But it's interesting that 1 Corinthians 12 talks about the body of Christ, and then 1 Corinthians 13 begins to tell us about love. Two could be connected here. First of all, he's making sure we understand who we are and what the church is and how we relate to one another. And then he's beginning to tell us, now you've got that picture. Jesus' commandment is to love one another, and here's what love looks like in the very next chapter. Interesting, huh? But it's one final thought. 1 Corinthians 12, 18 says, God has set the members, every one of them in the body, as it has pleased him. Now that's cool. That means that you're here in church tonight because God put you here. Isn't that profound? That's why you're here tonight. God wanted you in that chair. The very place, the very thing that you bring to the church, God chose you, and he didn't choose anybody else to be you. You are here because he chose you, and he put you in the body right where you are. That means you're an essential part. You know, you wouldn't be here otherwise. Christ understood who you were. He created you with the personality, the gifts, the talents. Some of you might think they're flaws, but God knows who we are when he made us. And you're here for a reason. You're here for a purpose. You're an integral, critical, vital part of his body on the earth, part of his mission, part of what he's doing. Amen? Christ placed all the parts of the body in there as it pleased him. So for me, I can't turn around and go, well, you know what, that brother just gets up my nose. He doesn't contribute anything. I don't like his attitude, and I wish he wasn't here. Big, big error, amen, on my part if I think like that. Because that's not what the Bible's telling us. So we've got to really understand who we are and what it is that we're a part of, amen? We're all here because God placed us here. And God placed us here because he's got some fantastic, great things that he wants us to be able to do as a group of people upon the earth. But the only way that's going to take place is if this organism, this machine, this body called the church, all the parts can function together to deliver the end result. And that's only going to happen if we can love one another. Amen. You get the picture tonight. Amen. Love your church. Love your neighbor. Love your church. Especially, the Bible says, especially let us do these things to those and amongst those who are of the household of faith. And that's you and I tonight. Bow your heads with me, amen. Let's close this evening. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for bringing us into the church tonight, Lord. God, I just thank you for my brothers and sisters, Lord God. Father God, for those that have worked with me over the years, Father God, those who taught me, those who have had patience, Father God, with my lack of understanding. Father God, just appreciate all that you have poured into my life through your church, Lord God. And I pray, God, that other people would have that same understanding. Give them that revelation tonight. And help us to see, Lord God, that the church is where we're fed, it's where we're nurtured, it's where we're raised up, it's where we receive your strength and your grace and your ministry. Thank you for your great, great wisdom in calling us into your church, Lord. If you've been blessed or challenged by today's preaching and you'd like to get in touch with us, the easiest way is via our website at www.newharvestuk.com. You can email us at info@newharvestuk.com or look us up on Facebook or Twitter. You can call us on 0161 278 6305 or you can even write to us at 194 Chapel Street, Salford, Manchester, M36BY. We'd also like to extend a warm welcome for you to join us at any of our services. However you might be feeling and whatever you might have been told, know this. God loves you and there's a place for you in his kingdom. God bless you, we're praying for you, and once again, thank you for listening.